During this MOOC, we have discussed many aspects of circularity, mostly focusing around technology, stakeholders, and design. Now we want to use the opportunity to put circularity in the built environment into the larger picture. To explore this today, we have David Peck at our studio. David is Associate Professor at the Faculty of Architecture and the Built Environment, with a circularity focus on materials, remanufacturing, and wider societal engagement. David, let me come with the first question. What is the urgency around going circular?
Well, thanks for asking me along today and coming in the studio with you. Urgency. Now, that's an interesting question, because urgency, you know, is always about time. You know, when you're in urgency in every day, have you got time to do something, and then you're under time pressure. So let's just look at circularity through the lens of time. How long have we got? Well, we can talk over hundreds of years, we can talk over many decades. I think the next decade ahead of us, from 2020 to 2030, that's the decade we've really got to focus on the time challenge. And what I'm interested in is, in the Netherlands, as you know, we talk about, and the government here has talked about, we really need to halve our material, energy, carbon, 50% less by 2030. That's an enormous challenge. You know, if we're going to do half by 2030, we're going to have to talk about 25% less by 2025, 5% less next year. Can you imagine that? I mean, how are we going to do that? That's a big challenge. But I think it's good to have that challenge, because then you give everyone, governments, companies, citizens, us, everyone, a sense of urgency and making it real. Now, this goes hand in hand with the Agenda 2030. What's Agenda 2030? The United Nations Sustainable Development Goals. 17 goals that everybody can look up online. And we need to hit those challenges by 2030 as well. And that would give us a great future on the planet as well. So that's fantastic. So we've got the 50% less by 2030, the 17 Sustainable Development Goals by 2030. But what we can't do is leave it to 2028 before we start doing anything. You know how it is in life. You put off everything until next time, next time, next time, and then it's too late to do it. We've got to start now. And that's the urgency that I think we really need to focus on.
So we need to get going soon.
Yep.
And our question is, of course, what do we do? What should we do? As mentioned before, we discussed a lot about technology. And what I believe is that technology might not be the biggest bottleneck. I mean, it is an issue. What we normally do is we isolate a problem. As engineers, we find a solution, we set requirements, find a solution. And so I'm pretty sure we will eventually find technological challenge answers. But the question is, of course, what else has to be done to support the transition to a circular built environment?
Yeah, that's a really good question. One of the big areas that I think can really drive things forward is the circular business model. So where companies, for-profit organizations, maybe not-for-profit sometimes, but particularly for-profit organizations, have a business model which is developed from the get-go around circular economy principles. Now, as you rightly say, I think, I like to say tech alone won't fix it. So the challenges that I just talked about, tech alone won't fix it. Absolutely essential that we do have technologies and that we're developing new technologies to provide the answers, but the business model needs to go with it. But here's another problem, the challenge that we've got to overcome. When you want to invest in business, when you want to develop new technologies and innovations for a circular economy, the big thing you're going to need is data and information. And I think we need data and information on a scope and scale that we haven't got right now. Now, once you develop up all that data information about things like material flows, about energy flows, who's got what, where, when, how do we share stuff, how do we remanufacture stuff, all this type of thing, you then have to ask yourself, who controls all that data? Who's in charge of the big data web that we're going to have for all this material? And those questions we do need to answer, because one thing I'm sure about, it's got to be fair. It's got to be fair to citizens, it's got to be fair to companies, it's got to be fair to everybody involved. And we need to build those constructs again, like I said earlier on. We don't have long, so we need to move on these things pretty fast. I think they are solvable because they are human challenges. We can mm-hmm. solve them, but we need to do those things as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you just mentioned an interesting aspect. Start like that. It always seems like circularity is driven by an industry-related technological approach, mm-hmm. and it's business-driven. Mm-hmm. So it's all about enabling commercial success yeah. to support the transition.
Yeah.
But we also should embrace a wider societal concept, which is about enabling people, mm. basically. Mm. I know you have a research project, a new one. Can you tell us something about that one?
I really would love to tell you more about it. Let me just unpack it a little bit, because it's complicated. We've got a super new project, as you've said. It's an exciting circular-based project. It's got a super name. It's called Pop Makena. How about that for a name? Pop Makena. It's funded by the European Union. It's a four-year program. It's got about 25 partners involved, so it's quite big. Big budget, about 10 million euros. It's super. We've got municipalities, cities. We've got companies. We've got universities and various other stakeholders as well, not-for-profits, all sorts of organizations involved. And what we want to do is develop up circular maker communities. And we've got 7 pilot cities where we're going to make that happen. So hold on, what's a circular maker community? Well, a circular maker community, you can find examples of this, like Fab Lab, you can mm-hmm. find Repair Cafe, you can find exchange hubs. There's all kinds of stuff that is going on in cities, what we could collectively call the circular maker communities. And we're going to help build this and grow this in these 7 cities. Which 7 cities? Fantastic. Venlo in the Netherlands, Leuven in Belgium, Thessaloniki and Piraeus in Greece, mm-hmm. Santander in Spain, Kaunas in Lithuania, and then Istanbul in Turkey. Do you know how big Istanbul is? They told me the other. It's massive. It's 18 million people in the greater region around Istanbul. Fantastic. So we go very small cities, very large cities, all across, all different types of cities, different challenges, different opportunities, and we're going to make that all happen. And we want to develop as well new businesses, as well as not-for-profit organizations as well, working with the community and different people in the community mm-hmm. as well, not just the normal tech business entrepreneurs. We're looking for what we call edge community people, people that sometimes get left out, people that everybody just pushes to one side and doesn't engage with. We want to target those people mm-hmm. as well. And we think we're going to create a blueprint for cities all over the world mm-hmm. to develop this type of activity. We can't wait to get started. It's going to be fantastic.
Great. So a really bottom-up approach on this one.
Bottom-up, and as well, we're going to be focusing on working with the municipalities mm-hmm. in the cities, so these key stakeholders.
I'd like to discuss another issue. Circularity is, in the Netherlands, and I know in some countries, really widely debated. Mm. And you hear critics already pointing out the conflict that might be between circularity and the wider concept of sustainability. What is your take on that?
Well, I said earlier on, personally, I don't care what we call it, as long as we're working towards those goals. We're trying to solve the big problems, the climate emergency we're seeing on the planet. It's in the news every day. There is an urgency there. I don't get too hung up about what we call things, but I am aware of these tensions. Mm-hmm. For some people, they really matter. And, if you call something this or you call something that, it really matters. I look over circularity in the longer term, and I look at some of the people who were influential in the very beginning. People like Walter Stahel, Bill McDonough, Michael Brangart, and many, many others were involved from the get-go. Now, they came from sustainability principles. Mm-hmm. And they are now seen as pioneers of a circular economy idea. So I'm kind of like not too bothered about it. I do see one thing, though, that there is this tension between for profit making money and the environment, the eco-environment. Mm-hmm. And there's a tension. How do you make money and not harm the environment? That's an age-old discussion that we've been going on for decades and even hundreds of years talking about. I think, as I said before, the urgency is we actually have to untangle that and solve that really quickly. What we call things, I'm not distracted by it, but I recognize it goes on.
Yeah, interesting debate.
Yeah, it's a long debate.
And we are just at the beginning. At the moment, we see a lot of uncertainty across companies and organizations and how to move on and how to start and how to develop viable economic approaches. So what should our learners do? What should we tell them? Why should they engage and how should they start?
A good question. I think one of the things, especially in for-profit organizations, and a lot of our learners are either in or will be in these types of organizations. Mm-hmm. One of the big problems for those organizations, they'll turn around and go, well, we'd love to do way more circular, but actually the customers are not asking for it, so we don't really know how we make money out of it. Or they turn around and go, well, society, the people on the course, around them and in society, they need to ask for this. And it's kind of difficult. And I see there a role for government. Now, government can, and when I say government, it could be local government, so it could be the municipality, it could be regional, it could be national, or even supranational, like the European Union, as an example. I mean, if you turn around and look at these types of organizations, in Europe, for example, this governmental spend, known as public sector procurement, the money government spends to provide the services for society, is about 20% of all our spend. It's a fifth. It's a massive amount of money. So I look at governments and I think, you're encouraging us to engage into circular. Why don't you buy circular? Mm-hmm. You go out to your supplying companies and say, everything you supply us now needs to be like this and like this and like this. Now that would give a massive boost to the circular endeavor, because you'd suddenly see that companies are going, well, our clients who spend a lot now want this. We need to work with our employees. We need to work with universities and colleges and schools. We need to make sure we've got a talent pool. Suddenly you see it would unlock the circular economy and really make it happen in the way we would like to see it happening. So I think that's a big opportunity space. And of course, don't forget, citizens can get involved in making sure who represents us on the local level and the regional level and the national level. They can engage through that way as well. But plus also, as I talked about before with the big project we've got, there are all sorts of not-for-profit organizations where people can just go and join and take action and start doing stuff. I think it's that way that people can get involved and really make a difference.
Well, thanks, Dave. Thanks for providing some insights and the context around circularity. We really believe that circularity in the built environment is more than a trend or a passing fashion. It is a promising approach that will help us address the challenges we all face. The approach has to be systemic and needs to create incentives for the industry to start the transition. But it also requires a broad societal acceptance. Enabling people is crucial to mitigate the negative consequences that a transition might have. As Dave said, the next 10 years are really critical.